The Gospel contains many sermons of Christ. The Sermon on the Mount holds a special place. It contains the moral law, which Christ calls on his adherents to follow. We may characterize the Sermon on the Mount as a self-portrait of Jesus Christ, because he formulated there the principles that he performed in his life. He formulated those traits that he himself possessed. The sermon starts with the Beatitudes, which contain the very essence of the spiritual and moral teaching of Christ. The first declaration of blessedness: Blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Poorness is understood to be a humility, a special spiritual state that comes from remembrance of God and the feeling of His presence. Humility is by no means a synonym for passiveness or humiliation. A Christian is called to have an active life position and good deeds. He shouldn't, however, make any merit of it, remembering that everything he has is given by God. В духовном и материальном плане он обязан Богу. Humility is the opposite of pride, that is, self-confidence and arrogance over other people, that puts difficulties between God and men and brings discord in interpersonal relationships. Second, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. This declaration of blessedness points that a Christian should be able to overcome all the sorrows patiently and not be afraid of misfortunes and ordeals, not to look for only joyous events and pleasure. It's necessary to see God's hand in the ordeals and to look for consolation in the feeling of God's presence. A Christian doesn't cry because of an offense or anger, despondency or despair, but because of recognition of one's own sins, penitential cries, or because of joy of deeper relationship with God, cries of tenderness. Third, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Meekness is a trait that can help to gain the inner spiritual rest. Jesus says, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Being the image of meekness, the Savior teaches his followers to imitate himself. Fourth, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Christ always looked for righteousness and fairness everywhere, and he teaches his followers to imitate him in that. In the Old Testament, the truth is known to be one of the qualities of God Himself. He is a righteous God. Human righteousness is the reflection of this divine truth. God's truth is timeless and eternal, but is reflected in commandments which were given by God to people who live in time. Those who do hunger and thirst after righteousness are those who strive to fulfill God's commandments, who wholeheartedly look for God, the source of every truth, who curb lawlessness as much as they can, and support the unfairly offended people. Five, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. A Christian should be merciful, imitating God Himself, who is merciful and gracious. Mercy should be shown not only in one's heart, but in the very particular acts of charity as well, which Christ will remind of to everyone during the Last Judgment. To feed the hungry, to give drinks to the thirsty, to provide shelter for strangers, to clothe the naked, to visit the sick or to come to those who are in prison. Apostle James says that the faith should be demonstrated in particular good deeds. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. 6. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. The purity of heart opens the way to seeing God. He is invisible by nature, but reveals himself to the gentle, meek, and pure of heart. It's impossible to gain the purity of heart only by one's own efforts. God's aid is needed. Create in me a new heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me, reads Psalm 50. God is waiting for repentance and contrition of heart from man. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise, reads the Psalm. 7. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Christ's disciples are called to be peacemakers, that is, to bring peace to the world around us. They should have the inner peace and unshakable fortitude. Saint Seraphim of Sarov said, "Acquire a peaceful spirit, and around you thousands will be saved." Peacemaker is the one who doesn't repay evil with evil, having got peace inside of him. If there is a conflict, he does his best to resolve it. 8. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Christ warns his disciples they should be ready for persecutions. The church has been persecuted for centuries in varying degrees. So it was during the first 3 centuries of the Church's existence, when all the might of punitive machine of the Roman Empire was focused on the destruction of the Church. So it was in the 20th century in the Soviet Union, when the Church was subjected to the cruelest repressions. But even in the peaceful and safe times, to be a Christian means to be ready to challenge this world with its corrupted and reversed ideas of happiness, of morality, of good and evil. 9. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely, for my sake. Here Jesus reveals himself to be not only the source of the Beatitudes, but also to be the main reason his followers will be persecuted for. They won't be persecuted because they are the poor in spirit, because they are meek, pure in heart, peacemakers, because they mourn, hunger, and thirst after righteousness. They will be persecuted because they believe in him, and they are his followers. In other words, they will be persecuted not because of some of their qualities, not because of following certain moral principles, but because they do it all in the name of Christ. They will be persecuted exactly as Christians. 10. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. The Beatitudes end with these words, which subvert conventional ideas of what happiness consists of. Christ calls on to rejoice and to be happy those very people who are persecuted, abused, and who are slandered. People think that happiness depends on the material welfare, success in the professional field, prosperity of the family, absence of problems, difficulties, ordeals, and sorrows. Jesus teaches that the true happiness or beatitude doesn't depend on the external factors at all. Happiness is an inner possession of man, gained by his own traits. The Beatitudes show that Christian morality is connected with the so-called universal morality only in some respects. If the universal morality is directed only to provide peaceful coexistence between subjects who are inherently extraneous to one another, the Christian morality is focused on human aspirations to the sanctity and spiritual perfection, which can unite people in the inseparable links of brotherly love.
Friends, we are entering into Lent, the way that will lead us into the holy week of Christ's passion and death, and next the glorious resurrection of Christ, in which the entire creation, along with us, rejoices in the defeat of death and the victory of life eternal, which we can begin experiencing now if we turn our life over entirely to Him. Many Orthodox in our American land and in Europe too have come in from other denominational experiences. Almost all of those experiences, both in the papacy and in the Protestant denominations, emphasize the external. And so the going to church, the Protestants, is necessary. Otherwise, the people around you will begin to criticize. These externals are especially rampant in the Catholic Church. Having been part of the religious community under the Jesuits, we were required during what was called chapter, we were required to not confess our own sin, but confess the sins of others, which completely reverts the Lord's own teaching of never judging others and judging only myself. So we are given false discipleships, people that don't know what they're doing, and then these same people come into Orthodoxy. What can go wrong there? In the Orthodox Christian faith, it is 2,000 years of living out the area and the preparation time for Lent in order to prepare our hearts for the great and glorious feast of the resurrection. Now, rules have developed over those thousands of years, and monastics are usually the ones who are intense about their prayer life, and they require more fasting because of that. Therefore, lay people who are fasting do not follow set rules. Because of our work and environment of secularism, we have to be careful not to offend those around us and yet train our own passions to be in order and in control. So we have people coming in who are used to keeping other rules from other denominations and the papacy. So they are inclined to apply this same attitude to the fasting in Great Lent. Please let us not become Pharisees at the time when we have to become the publican, humble and asking the Lord for forgiveness of my own sin. That means I can't look at my others and assign sin to them when it is obviously simply not being able to keep a rule. To give you the feeling that is attending Orthodox fasting from the apostles in line with the Holy Scriptures, one of the priests whom I admired greatly at a cathedral nearby was, by the way, he wept his way through the Divine Liturgy. The gifts of the Spirit were evident in this wonderful priest. And we were chatting after Divine Liturgy, and one lady was talking to this priest. I was overhearing this. She said, "Oh, it's easy for me because I'm a vegetarian. So Lent is really easy." To which the holy priest said, "Then, my dear, you must eat meat." Now, to those coming into Orthodoxy from a strict Mennonite, for instance, background, they would be horrified. But you see, the object is not the food. The object, as Father was telling her, is the attitude of my heart and keeping my passions, including my pride in being a vegetarian, in check and hopefully removed from my personality. It makes us haughty and arrogant, which becomes the devil's fast and not the Lord's fast of the humble and the meek of heart. What is the remedy, dear ones, for Pharisees in my own heart first, and so obvious as we're counting bows and prostrations in our neighbors, if we happen to see them out of the corner of our eye? Of course, we do not watch. That is one of the secrets, is keeping the eyes to ourselves. But what is the answer? Love. The Lord wants love and not sacrifices. He wants our hearts. He doesn't want us to count calories or to count what we're eating as pro or con in our spiritual life. He wants to take over our lives. And for that, we look at the Song of Solomon in a holy and pure way, as the Orthodox Fathers always say. It is the love between Christ and each of us in his church. We are all called to be brides of the bridegroom. That is our soul, who is longing and pining away in this earth, which is so full of horrors and tragedies. We're looking for the kingdom to come. Our hearts long for him because his presence is the kingdom of God. The voice of the Lord says in chapter 5, "I am come into my garden, my sister, my spouse. You are mine. I have gathered my myrrh with my spices. These are the sorrows I have borne for you. I have eaten my honeycomb with my honey, as I showed my friends after my resurrection. I have drunk my wine with my milk. Eat, O my friends, at this wedding banquet. Drink, yes, drink abundantly, O beloved one." And then we answer, "But my heart wakes. It is the voice of my beloved that knocks, saying to me, 'Open, open your heart to me, my love, my dove, my beautiful one, for my head is filled with dew. I need to tabernacle in your heart. I have put off my coat, How shall I put it on? Says the beloved, listening to the voice and responding, I am all ready for bed. But my beloved put his hand in the door, and my heart saw his hand moving toward me. I rose to open to my beloved. My hands dripped with sorrow, myrrh, which is the symbol of sorrow, for my sin, and my fingers with sweet-smelling myrrh, anointing him with my sorrows. Upon the handles of the lock, ready to open, to receive him into my heart. I opened to my beloved, the next verse, but my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. My heart failed when he spoke. I looked for him all over. I could not find him. I called for him. But he gave me no answer. How many of us have called out to the Lord in time of need when he promised not to leave us nor forsake us? So we remind him, Lord, you promised to be with us. The next verse. The watchman that went about the city found me. They wounded me with his love. They stripped away everything, these are the evil angels, and took my protection from me, my veil. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, those who are in the church, tell him that I am sick. I am sick with love for him and that I need to find him. This is the call of the missionary. What is the beloved more than any other woman? Now we get to the special beloved, the Holy Virgin Theotokos, who bore him, who was prepared to receive him as no other, in order to give him a human nature so that he could use that human nature to show us how to live as godly men and how to suffer under the situations that come to us in the world, how to face the enemy as he did and conquer. No other did this. A human being like that of his mother, because she had to do it without the divine nature to help her. She is a human being like you and me, but her incredible virtue required that the angel say, rejoice, O full of grace. This is her charge. She will help us find him. And when we have found him, she will help us please him and love him as we ought. Yes, now we have seen that once and for all, the Lord came to his Holy One, whom he calls a bride, his only bride, who actually became his mother in the flesh. The person of Christ came from only one bride in history. But what was this all about? He said, I have come to cast fire on the earth. So we know this is one instant that will have eternal repercussions. As we read in St. Simeon, the new theologian, he explains about the bread of the Eucharist and the wine. and listen to this mystery. The same undefiled flesh which he accepted from the purity of the mother, Mary, and with which he was given birth in the body, he gives to us as food. And when we eat of it, each one of us receives within ourselves the entirety of God made flesh. Our Lord Jesus Christ, present in the body, bodilessly, in his risen form, and so mingled with our essence and nature, and deifying us who share this holy body, who are become flesh of his flesh and bone of his bone. In this union, it is called the second mode of birth of God the Word. It occurs by the divine Spirit, which is ever working in our hearts, as we come to the Eucharist banquet with the mystery and love of him in our hearts. By communicating in the deified, risen flesh of Christ, the saints are elevated to the rank of his mother, his brothers, and his kinsmen, as he even said himself. This, he concludes, is the mystery of the marriages which the Father has arranged for his only begotten Son. And, dear ones, this accounts for the several instances in which he has called the kingdom of God like a wedding banquet. How can we love the Lord adequately in return for this great love he has given to us from all eternity in this new dispensation of the new covenant in his blood? Let us rejoice and become brothers with one another and sisters, because this is the meaning of his church, united in one body and one flesh, for his glory.
Thank you.
Now that the missionary has trained his heart and trained his passions not to go with every whim, and now that he has filled himself with the love of the Lord in prayer by reaching out and in receiving in return the wonderful bridegroom, himself the risen Christ, in the bread and the wine infused with his energies and his power, the Holy Spirit operating in the person that has died to the world and now is brought alive into Christ through baptism and nourished continually every day, every week. And with his life filled to the brim and overflowing like a reservoir filled with many days of rain and showers. Now, dear ones, we have the waters of life to give to the world around us. The most succinct view we could get of this happening is the Russian Renaissance now. After the blackness of the winter and the ice and cold of atheism, now the people are free to search out in their hearts the holy Christian faith, the Orthodox faith that they've known before and that they have died for. Now there is a renaissance. Let's learn from these missionary people to reconquer this world for Christ in a gentle and wonderful way, and the joy and the peace will follow every step of the way. Let's watch and learn.
Under Lenin, and particularly under Stalin, Christians were the enemies of the state. Churches were destroyed, priests and nuns jailed, often murdered. Even church bells and religious music were banned. Well, how times have changed. In the new Russia, there's been a Christian revival, a kind of resurrection, and its missionaries are out in force spreading the word. A lazy late summer afternoon on the River Don in southern Russia. Then, out of the blue comes a vision that shows maybe God does work in mysterious ways. Reverence interrupts the reverie. After 70 years of banishment under communism, Christianity in Russia is being born again. Here, on one of the nation's great waterways, young missionaries are once again calling the faithful back to the Orthodox Church.
You must acknowledge this is an extraordinary scene, a floating church coming down the river. You don't see that in too many parts of the world.
Many people would call it a miracle.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's what we think, it's a miracle. Yeah, it's unbelievable.
Just a miracle?
Just a miracle, yes. Why not?
And to understand this miracle, there's no better place to start in Moscow than right next door to the Kremlin, at the Cathedral of Christ the Savior.
The parishioners here today grew up under atheism. At first glance, the cathedral itself looks as though it's been around for 1,000 years. But this majestic building is actually brand new. It was built to replace one that was deliberately destroyed. It's hard to believe now that Joseph Stalin had the original church here blown up and replaced with a municipal swimming pool.
In the Stalinist times, they wanted also to control every aspect of the life of the people and every personality. They didn't want any ideological opposition, any alternative idea in the society.
Stalin surpassed Hitler in his brutality. Millions were arrested, tortured, and executed. Among them, countless priests, nuns, and churchgoers.
A number of priests were executed in a very cruel way, hanged or shot.
Father Zedlod Chaplin's church complex in Moscow was spared demolition, but Stalin had it converted into a prison.
One church was used for a club of the prison. Another church, I think, was used as a sporting hall and the administrative building of the prison. This building was a building for prison cells.
For some reason, the communists had a particular loathing for church bells. Russian bells aren't easy on the ear, but that was no justification for banning them all through the Soviet years. Many were simply destroyed. Some, for maximum symbolic effect, were tipped from rooftops.
What would have happened if you'd rung the bells the way you did today during Stalin's time?
I could be found in the prison somewhere in the north of Russia with a 10 years sentence in prison.
Just for ringing the bells?
Yes, for ringing the bell.
The communists used Father Andrei Dorokin's church to house circus animals. And for good measure, they confiscated the bells. Bells that some Orthodox Christians actually believe have a soul through which God speaks directly.
It's not an action of my hands, it's an action of God. I'm only a performer, but it's a ringing of God's soul.
Remarkably, the Russian Church's holiest of holies, the Zagorsk Monastery, survived. It's an astonishingly ornate and quite spectacular place, dating from the 1400s. Here, for instance, pilgrims can touch the right hand of St. Stephen, the first of the Christian martyrs. The monks still pray every day at 5 a.m., much the same as they probably did 500 years ago. And still hold the faithful in awe. Here too, past the saints and patriarchs, young men are inducted into the priesthood. So strong is the church revival that this year there are just on 1,000 priestly pupils. That's more than ever before. And every one of them is on a mission to reassert the church's influence in every corner of Russia. Here, though, the mission is unique. For the past few summers, when the ice on the Don River melts, this converted barge, with its little band of missionaries, visits hundreds of tiny villages, places too small and poor to have a church of their own. There's Father Gennady and his wife Maria. Their twin sons, Peter and Nikolai, who double as altar boys. There are also three deckhands and a helmsman. And, of course, a choir, Sveta and Anya. They have joined the River Crusade while on holidays. When not singing, they teach English at university.
But we came to religion only when we were 25.
Yeah, it was just about 6 years ago.
Is that right?
Yeah. Actually, I'm not sorry to say this, but the first of our first religion was the Beatles, actually.
Yeah, that was when we were 14.
14, yes. That's something we really believed in very seriously.
Generations of czars, wars without end, and 70 years of communism have all come and gone, but in the villages around here, little seems to have changed. Old-time religion is back, and with all the old beliefs and rituals. Some of the truly devout believe that Stalin, instead of destroying the church, actually made it stronger.
Some people in the church say that in order to go back to true religion, the church needed to give a lot of martyrs, you see, and also all this period of civil war and then the concentration camps built by Stalin where millions of people died, and in a way World War II was like our...
purification, kind of.
Yes, and a sacrifice, in a way, that we had to give in order to get our religion back.
But even the strongest faith has its limitations. On this day, lacking heavenly guidance and earthly navigation, the church ran hard aground on a sandbar. The prayers of Father Gennady and the special songs of praise, we were stuck fast. Well, for 12 hours anyway, and then, miraculously, we were back in motion, back on schedule. Father, over the 4 years that you've been doing this, how many people do you think you might have baptized?
I don't keep exact figures, but it would be over 2,000.
And here in the back blocks, every soul counts. The Orthodox Church believes Russians are vulnerable right now, vulnerable to interlopers from the other faiths.
Are you worried that if you don't do this, then others like Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons will come and steal some of your flock?
Of course. Over the last 80 years, the Church almost has not existed, and people are not educated enough. It's very easy to teach them wrong things. Missionaries come from other countries and they try to preach things that contradicts Christ's teaching. We find that very dangerous, and that's why we are trying to bring them back to the church.
Even today, for most Russians, life is still very hard. And many are now seeking comfort in the old ways.
Of history where monks would leave the cities, they would go out into the wilderness, into the desert, into the mountains, and even into the ocean, looking for that quiet, peaceful place where they could meet God and end their life.
Jesus Christ, will I come to the setting of the sun and behold him in light? Praise the Father.
A monk is someone who wants to pursue for the rest of his life Christ in a really intense way. He doesn't want to be distracted with the things of the world, with family life, and he wants to focus completely on his life with Christ. But it's not a selfish thing in the sense that he's only trying to save himself. A monk believes that if he does what he hopes to do, to follow Christ for the rest of his life and to live a prayerful life, that it will be for the benefit not only of himself, but for the whole world. That the prayers he raises to God, as sinful as he may be, that they have value and that it calls down the mercy of God upon the world.
Very often people call in and mention how they were healed after prayers to St. Panteleimon. And glory be to God that the saints listen to our prayers.
Around 2005 or 2006, after Margaret was diagnosed with cancer, and we started coming here from Elevens to St. Panteleimon, and we would frequently ask the monks for prayers.
They told me my cancer, that it had spread a lot and was terminal.
But through the mercy of God and through all the prayers of the monks and through the help of St. Panteleimon, I was healed of cancer.
By the novices and the monks trying to repent, trying to struggle with their passions, grow closer to Christ, live a life of prayer, confess their sins, and repent and change, the whole world becomes a better place. We don't have to necessarily go out and do missionary work. Pilgrims come here, which is wonderful, but our main work is really prayer, prayer for the whole world, prayer for our country, prayer for our church, prayer for the poor, prayer for the sick. That's our job, that's our duty, that's our obligation. And that's why we are where we are.
Give love to everybody, not only to the monastics, but also to all the visitors that come here.
Все монахи – это англоговорящие, американцы. Песнопения исполняются тоже по-английски.
All Americans.
Но знамены
The hymnody is sung in English as well, but in Russian знамены
chant.
Their monastic traditions are strictly Russian.
Если посмотреть на
One look at a photograph of the monks and you get the impression you are looking at Valaam or Opti. They wear the same klobuks, the same rasas. They have the same schedule of divine services.
Thank you.
Grand victories to the Orthodox Christians.
Here, there's a purpose to everything, to every hour of every day. So when you lay down to sleep, you say your prayer, say your Jesus prayer, and if you wake up the next morning, then it's time to pray again, to do some spiritual.
Thee is due praise, to thee is due a song, to thee glory is due, to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever and unto the ages of ages.
I think a monk here has to really decide that he is ready to pursue this kind of life for the rest of his life, that he's not looking for a leisurely time, and that he's going to pray hard and work hard. He's really going to struggle. And with the support of the other brothers, it becomes a little bit easier, because he looks around and he sees that his other brothers are also working really hard. They're working on themselves. They're pursuing Christ. They're trying to follow Christ. They're trying to die to the old man. And they're also working hard for the monastery, that they believe in the mission of the monastery.
Since we've been in West Virginia, the monastery has had trouble financially.
We found that it's a really big challenge to support and build the monastery just with some little handicrafts like incense and with the occasional but unpredictable donations.
We've nearly doubled in size in the last 2 to 3 years. So the positive aspect is it keeps you reliant on God. The more human element is that it many times makes you nervous or perhaps anxious about where the money is going to come from. A lot of times the bill sheet of all the bills that we have to pay comes to me, and I'm looking at tens of thousands of dollars every month. Traditionally, we have never been able to pay those off all at once. It's always you pay a little bit, but you're always behind. The trap is the most pressing need probably is building new cells for monks, because monks that come here, several of them, we have to tell them, do you have enough money to build your own cell, because we can't pay for this. So there is not enough housing right now for the monks. Some of them living in RVs or the basement of the guest house. Sometimes guests are having to camp out because we don't have room for them.
The news of the support coming from the FFA really brought a lot of joy to the hearts of the brothers here, and I think they felt that, well, the Orthodox Church and people in general really do want the monastery to succeed, and they proved it by making those donations to the fund.
Yes,
America needs 20 times the number of monasteries we have. Much larger monasteries, bigger guest house, bigger churches to minister to our ailing, our spiritually ailing society. And hopefully, through people contributing to the Fund for Assistance and coming to visit monasteries and praying for us as we pray for them, this will all come about. Things will begin to change, and our country can become spiritually more nourished and more solid and powerful and more peaceful. In this humble little monastery, many people come to terms with God and with Himself and reorient their life toward Christ in a way that they could never do out in the world. The most important service of the monastery is our prayers.